Praise the Lord, happy Sabbath. One of my favorite songs, what a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. I pray that's your desire of your heart today. You're looking forward right to the coming of Jesus. You'll be able to see him one of these days face to face with Christ my Savior. Face to face, what will it be? So I pray today with anticipation that you're looking as you approach this new year, as you see it. First few days in it right now, the coming of Jesus is right nearer than it was yesterday and the day before. He's soon to come, and sometimes people say ready or not, he's going to come. Let's be ready. What do you say? Let's make that commitment to God as we spend this time together today. And as usual, as we study the Word of God, we're going to be talking about the subject is let my people go. Let my people go, part one. And before we open the beautiful pages of this inspired book, the book that will lead us and to guide us, equip us, and give us power, give us direction, understand the will of God, I want to pray once again that the Holy Spirit will take control of each of our hearts and minds, that it's not a waste of time because we are here, because we're in the presence of God Almighty. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, the angels, we have to sense the presence of the living God is here. Be still, he says, and know that I am God. Shall we pray together? Merciful Father in heaven, again, I ask in a very special way that you send your Holy Spirit, open my heart, my mind, my lips, that your Holy Spirit will speak the words that we all need to hear. I do not know where your children are at. We look in a mirror for self-examination, and we know that we have needs. And so, Father, as we come before thee, as you look upon your children today, I know that you have a word in due season because you promised in your word. Now we pray that your Holy Spirit will take control of our hearts and our minds. Many times the minds at this point in the service get just a little bit lazy, sometimes a little bit sleepy. But Lord, I pray your Holy Spirit will stir us into action to redeem the time Jesus is soon to come. I ask that you forgive me my sins, mistake, anything in my heart and life that needs not be there. Lord, I need to hear your voice today. And I thank you, your people need to hear your voice. Speak to us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I know you brought your sword along with you. If you didn't, I'll just say shame on you, and I'll let it go at that. Okay? We have to have our swords. You know, if you don't, how do you know what's being spoken is the truth? And most generally, we're never studying to show ourselves approved unto God. We're worried about waiting somebody else to do the work for us. And friend, that's not going to happen. God's given you a brain, right? He's given us insight. He's told us what we need to be doing. And we need to just simply do it. And I pray in this year that we will hear the voice of God and we will respond to the voice of God. I feel like this subject matter is not one that you have heard over and over the years, because as I've studied it again, the Lord has brought new thoughts to my mind and new spiritual aspects of it that I hadn't really thought of before. And I thank him for that, because so often I believe this, let my people go. And I believe it's not just in the time of Moses. I believe it's today. The enemy has come in, subtle as he can be. We don't even recognize it. And I say today, let my people go. But God requires action on our part. The devil is not about to let you go unless Christ shows up. He has to be first and foremost in your heart and in your mind. I read it just a couple of lines, and I'd like to start with that today. Manuscript 3, 1885, this was written. Please listen to the words. Those who exalt their own ideas above the plain specified will of God are saying as Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice? Did anybody get that today? Any person that simply exalts their own ideas, their emotions, their feelings, I think, above the specified will of God. In other words, the clear word of God. We say, well, we know it, we've read it, we see what it's saying here, but we're saying exactly what Pharaoh said. Who is the Lord. Who is he that I should serve him? What boldness that took for a mere man to say, who is the Lord? Who's God that I should obey him? But let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, there's millions, yea, billions in the world today that are saying the same thing. Who's the Lord that I should obey him? I know what the word says. I've read it. But who is he? Why should I do it? I don't care to be different. I don't care to be strange in this world, some people say. I'd rather be with the majority rather than in the minority. And so we go day after day, and we need to be crying out to God, let my people go. You know why? The devil has a hold. And anyone today say, well, I'm not sure. You know, we need to rethink the issue. Turn with me in your Bible, if you will, to Exodus chapter 20. Or Exodus chapter 2, we're going to read verses 23 through 25. Back in the beginning of the Exodus chapter 2. Exodus chapter what? 2. Very good. Thank you. I like to hear that familiar voice of Brother Bobby in the back. He may be in the corner over there, but he's with the program. Praise God. Anytime I say the Bible passage, he's right there with it. Praise God. And I know many of you are too. And if you're not, please get with it, okay? Exodus chapter 2. It's the right thing to do, isn't it? It's the right thing to do that we come together and we're, say, you know, all the world says, let's get on the same page. Have you ever heard that? Let's get on the same page. We're not on the same. In the Word of God, how much more important that is to be on what? The same page. Let's be thinking and reading together. Exodus chapter 2, verses 23 through 25. It says, and it came to pass in the process of time that the king of Egypt died. And the children of Israel sighed. By reason of the bondage, they cried. And their cry came up to who? Unto God. By reason of their bondage. God heard their groanings. God remembered his covenant with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel. And God had respect unto them. That's an interesting word. God had respect unto them. God recognized them. He was aware of them. He had a knowledge of them in regard, understanding. He had an understanding of his people. Praise God that we have a God who is concerned about us, that he knows us. This year, as we start this new year, a thing that's been impressed on my mind an awful lot is that God knows us intimately. He cares about us like there's no one else on the face of this earth. That's an awesome thought. I'll read that in a moment, and I thought as I read this passage, when Moses was trying to get out of doing what God had commissioned him to do, and he said his voice, you know, he didn't have the speech. And it's interesting the response that God made. We'll read that a little bit later on. But God said to him, you know what? I know your brother Aaron. And I know his speech is good. God knows our speech. And he looked down. He said, I know your brother, and your brother speaks well. God knows who's speaking well in and among his people today. He's very well aware of who's doing what and why they're doing what they're doing. Is it for the accolades of men? Is it for position? Is it for money? What might it be? Why are you doing what you're doing? When God calls you into service, let my people go. Notice the passage says, in the process of time, as time passed by, God noticed he had his eye on his children, and he began to say, I know they're in bondage, and I'm going to free them. You may be in bondage today. I may be in bondage today with some things of this world. It's just as real as the children of Israel who were produced and lived in slavery. Because sin is that way. It puts you into slavery. You're a slave, right, to that master. Whatever it might be, it may just be a little thing in this world, but somehow it's holding you back. It's preventing you from doing what God asked you to do and the calling. And Moses said, you know, at the time, I'm ready to go, Lord. And the Lord said, no, you're really not. Many times we say we're ready and we're really not ready. We think we're ready. We think we know. And if anyone had the wisdom and the knowledge, Moses had it. He did. But God says it's going to be about another 40 years. We'll read that a little more. You understand that well. The time for the children of Israel to be free had come. But still there were things that needed to be accomplished because God's going to do, right, for us what we cannot do, what? For ourselves. He expects us to do all that we know. And then He promises to do the rest. Children of Israel had been enslaved, as it were, for 400 years. And again, the controversy, we won't get into that day. In one place, the New Testament says 430 and 400. You can reason that out. You can study the Scriptures. You can find it has perfect, you know, it bonds together rather well as you study the subject. We're not going to do that at this point. But I know in Acts chapter 7, verse 7, as you read the New Testament, it says, they shall come forth and serve me. They were in bondage. They could not serve God the way God wanted them to do. In fact, in their servitude, in their slavery, they could not keep the seventh-day Sabbath. Somebody's not with me. Very interesting, because you say, well, what do you mean keeping the seventh-day Sabbath when the law wasn't even given at this point in time on Mount Sinai? Did you get it? They knew, didn't they? How did they know? It was given in the very beginning in creation, wasn't it? And it was passed down. They knew, well, they could not serve God the way God said to serve them. And they weren't serving Him. They were not obeying Him. That's why He allowed them to go into servitude, so that they would be humbled and they would repent and come back to Him. How sad that must have been to take in so long. You and I look at 2 or 3 years and we say that's kind of a long time. 400 years, as it were, 430 years. Why did it take so long for the people of God to get it? Why has it taken us so long and still yet we don't have it? We're missing some things and we don't realize that we're missing some very vital, important points of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Salvational issues. We think we have them. We don't have them. If we have them, our lives will change. Our thoughts will change. Our attitude will change. We're missing something. Israel was missing something, and God allowed them to go into Egypt and serve. And we look at it as Christians today, and we say, well, how could that be good for the children of Israel? For God to allow them to go into pagan practices. Long period of time to where they almost forgot the real God of heaven. You realize that? Do you realize in your own life, if you have yourself and you have your children, and then you have grandchildren, and by the time that just a couple of generations down there, what? People have forgotten. If it's not reinforced, the importance in our family, if mom and dad doesn't pass it to their children and they accept it and grasp it strongly, they lose. And then their children, they even lose some more. And then the next one, they don't know anymore. And all these years, Israel had turned right just about like the Egyptians. They were doing the same thing, most of them, pagan practices. And God said, there'll become a time that I'm going to have to bring them forth that they might serve me. Oh, you want to read that? Well, good for you. Let's do that, shall we? Turn in the book of Psalms with me, if you will, please. Why did it come to a certain point in time and God said, I'm going to free my people? Remember, there were times that they thought before they would be freed, but yet the children of Israel were not ready to be freed until a certain time. The leader was not ready until a certain time, and God's people had to be on their toes and ready for deliverance. Lessons to be taught. The book of Psalms 105. Psalms 105. Excuse me. 105, we're going to read verses 42 through 45. Psalms 105, 5, verses 42 through 45. Now remember, there was one reason. This is the big reason that God wanted to free His people. Notice what it is. It says, "For He remembered His holy promise and Abraham His servant, and He brought forth His people with joy and His chosen with gladness, and He gave them the lands of the heathen, and they inherited the labor of the people," notice this, "that they might observe His statutes, keep His laws, praise ye the Lord." What does that mean? He brought them forth, right, for one purpose, that they might serve Him. They were not allowed to serve. We'll study that a little bit more as we go, because Pharaoh was demanding many things of them. Children of Israel wanted to take off time, and there's more time that they would take off, you see, and try to say, the Pharaoh, more work to be done. We'll see. But God said, "I'm going to free them that they might observe His statutes." Original language, that's simply His enactments. That's His commandments. That's His decree. That's His law. That's His ordinances. That covers it, does it not? It's statutes and to keep His laws. And let me tell you, dear friends, what that is in the original language. That is the Decalogue. Are you with me? That's His precepts. Talking about His Ten Commandments. Why? Because of the situation that His people were in, they were forced not to keep the Seventh-day Sabbath. They were put in a position to where they would have to either die if they refused, or they would continue to work. And God said, "No, because I put My statutes out there, My commandments and My law, and I'm going to free them so that they can observe them." Freedom. Praise God. You want that freedom? Let My people go. An overview in Exodus, if you turn back there, chapter 2, we find that Moses is born. Exodus chapter 2, Moses is born. Now remember, this is what? An overview. That means you have homework. That means you need to get in and read and dig. Exodus chapter 2, Moses is born. And you know he's born about 135 years after Jacob's entry into Egypt. A lot of this stuff is good if you try to put things together in timetables here. Just food for thought for us here. Moses is born, what? 135 years after Jacob's entry into Egypt. Interesting how Jacob got there. How did he get there? He just walked in and said, "I'm here"? No. He was taken too into, right, to custody, into slavery, as it were. God used him. But very interesting, when the 7 years of problems arrived, that all of a sudden, you know, people begin to say, "Ooh, wait a minute, we got some problem." We'll study that a little bit more here. Jacob's entry into Egypt. Moses was the third child, right, of Jochebed. Now you had first what? Jochebed was the mother. Yeah, first Moses was the third child. So Aaron was, the Bible says, about 3 years, right? Aaron was 3 years older than Moses. And Miriam, his sister, was older than he was. And we'll understand that because you say, "Well, I'm not sure." Remember, as the baby was put into the water, you remember who was watching over the baby? His sister. She couldn't have been real old, but she was there. And boy, did God use her and some wisdom He put in her mind to convince. We'll see that as we read again. Very interesting. And so we had Aaron, we had Miriam and Aaron and then Moses in chapter 2, verse 4. You can read that. Moses was, according to Acts chapter 7, the New Testament account, verse 20, literally as he was looked upon as a baby, they said the baby, he was attractive. Interesting. The word is even used beautiful to God. King James Version tells us he was exceedingly fair. The Bible said he was a goodly child. Interesting. And you know, as we read more, you find out that Moses was, God gave him quite a few gifts up here. Very talented. Moses was born at a time when the Hebrews, or the children of Israel, as a race, was magnifying. That means they were growing. Listen, there's a reason. They were growing faster, even in captivity, than the Egyptians were. Are you still with me? Remember, why would that be? You can read that in Exodus chapter 1. Because number one is the promise that God made to, remember he gave to them, Abraham, in Genesis chapter 15, verses 14 through 18. He talked about their seed. Do you remember that growing? And the promise that he made to Jacob. Do you remember that? In Genesis 46, verse 3. He said, I'm going to make you a great nation. Genesis 22, 17. The Bible says you're going to be like the stars of the heavens. And so how could this be? And notice what happened because of. How could it be that the children of Israel in slavery, in captivity, were growing, having more children as it were, and growing a lot faster than the Egyptians were? And what would be the cause of what it would cost Israel? But again, because of the promises of God, right? Because God said he would bless and multiply their seed. That's beautiful. The promises of God are what? Are sure. Even in a time when it doesn't seem like it can work, God's blessings begin to flow. The seed would multiply. But listen, this brought about a fear that the Hebrews, as they were growing in population, even in captivity, would somehow become friends with maybe some other nations and they would conquer and overthrow the Egyptians. This brought about some concern. Overthrow them in what? In an effort to make sure that this population explosion would end. The Pharaoh said, we're going to have to keep them busier than they've ever been before. If they've had time off before to observe certain things, they're not going to have any time off anymore. I'm going to afflict the people of God with much more work. And the interesting, notice, the more Pharaoh afflicted the people of God, the more the people of God kept growing. So remember, when the enemy afflicts the people of God, is a growth time for us. It's not a time to give up. It's not a time to say defeat. So in the circumstances of life that seems impossible where they were at, under the circumstances that they were in. Let me tell you, even said, you know, part of, we'll talk about a little bit more too. We talk about that even in childbirth, the Israelite women, right, gave birth to child a lot easier than the Egyptians did because they worked physically. They were in good physical shape. And because they were, you didn't have to have the ladies to come in, you know, to help midwives to give birth. And that's how many, many hundreds, maybe thousands of little boys were saved. Why is this important, what we're talking about here? Remember, then, because they continued to multiply, because the threat of being overthrown, because Israel, people were really growing here, they became friends with others. Oh my, we're going to be put out of our office, our kingdom. Somebody else is going to take care of. A death decree was issued. Very interesting, if we look at the end of time, the death decree is issued, and the death decree will be issued because the people of God, be careful now, but multiplying. Not necessarily maybe even in so much in numbers, but the message that they give and how it goes into the world, we're going to find a death decree that will be given again. And this death decree went on all males. And so they had their women, as it were, the Egyptians who were supposed to be with the midwives, were supposed to be with the Israelite ladies. And the Bible even talks about it. It says when their feet was on the stones, that was when they was giving birth. When they were on the stone, that you'd be there, and if a male comes out, he's killed, he's put into water, drowned, or whatever, but they would kill them. They're going to stop this explosion here. And, you know, read that in Exodus chapter 2. You can read that 16 through 22. Interesting, as the death decree was put into effect, Moses was born at that time. It doesn't seem to be a long period of time that it was in effect. And the reason was, it once again, think with me, one of the reasons was it again is because of what happened to Moses and who received Moses. Are you still with me? Moses born at the time of a death decree. He lived naturally through the birthing process. He was hid, but he was hid for only 3 months. Do you remember? Because he got a little older, afraid to be found out. And certainly in the planning of God, there's no doubt about this. The mother and the family felt like, you know what, we better try to make other arrangements because if they find him, they will kill him. And I believe that the mother and I believe the family realized that there was something special about this child. He was going to do something special for the cause of Christ. So he was hid for 3 months, but you know, and then he was put in a little boat. We're not going to read it. You can read it for yourself. And the little boat was called an ark, you remember, right? And he began to float. The Pharaoh's daughter found him when she went out to bathe. She kept him. And then Moses is, listen, interesting. The baby was taken from the mother, but when what God's plan was is for the mother to take care of her own child. Is somebody with me? The sister was hid in the bushes. Are you still with me? The boat passes by, right? The queen, as it were, she sees it, or the daughter. She comes out, oh, look, and they open it up, and they say, oh, boy, it's a little Hebrew. Little Hebrew was crying. Pharaoh's daughter had compassion. And all of a sudden, there's Miriam. And she said, would you like for me to get somebody to take care of this little baby for you? And naturally, Pharaoh thought, well, yes, would you do that? And so who did Miriam go get? Went and got Mama, the real mother. There's a reason for that. The real mother was called to nurse and to care for her child. God's plan has succeeded once again. Not only was Moses saved from death, but he was returned to his own family. Are you still with me? And listen, it gets better. Not only was he returned to his own mother to nurse and to grow, but to be taught. And mother got paid for being mother. Somebody's not with me. God goes another step beyond what you and I can even think. Baby returned, and then the prince is right. What she said there, the daughter, Pharaoh's daughter said, well, we're going to pay you. The mother was paid. What a blessing that was. Paid to care for her own child. In God's plan, why? That he might receive instructions from his mother first. Why? Because for the first impressions of life that baby takes in, right, is from the mother. The importance of that. And this mother was a godly mother, and she implanted in this little baby, which would not have happened in the courts of Egypt. But God made sure that very important time, until he was about 12 years of age, mother kept him, the real mother, and she told him about the things of God. She prayed with him. She taught him. And these things were instilled in his heart and in his mind. The first impressions of God in life were indelibly imprinted on this little baby's mind because of mother. And think what some of you mothers are doing, maybe not necessarily here, but the mothers in the world, of what they're impressing indelibly upon their poor little children that they will carry on in this life. And even it's sad. Why do you think that God gave you that child? It's to be raised what? For heaven, for eternity, wasn't it? For God and His service. But yet we raise them for everything else. We raise them for Batman and Spider-Man and Superman, all this junk in the world today, rather than the things of God. The importance of those first few years of obedience. She taught him obedience. She taught him to deny self. She taught him about the true God of the universe, because he would soon be subject to the pagan practices of the world. He would have a stepmother, as it were, a good mother. A father, the Pharaoh, right? You know, we say father, you know. He would see all of these things taking place in the world. But these things that mother implanted in that child's mind is so important. I read this in the Adventist Home, page 238, and it can be any home. Somebody listen up. It said the whole future life of Moses, the great mission which he fulfilled as the leader of Israel, testified to the important work of the Christian mother. Did you get that? Sometimes mothers forget the importance of their work. Greatest work that can be done is your children. And yet how often we let them get away with everything. The importance of the work of the Christian mother. They are placed in the care of and to be trained not as heirs to the throne of an earthly empire, but they're to be trained as kings unto God to reign with Him in through unending ages. We're to train them for heaven, not to be superior, not for the things of this world, not to be like the world, involved in things with the world, but up, be in and out around the world more than they are with the godly people, but they're to be trained to be kings unto God. And how often we forget that, and how sad, what a reaping that's going to be. The importance. The whole future life of Moses, did you get that? Had to do with the first few years of his life. It helped him to make the decisions that he made later on as a grown-up. Did you get that? Without that, he wouldn't have made those. He couldn't. Praise God, we serve a God in heaven who overrules and makes things right turn out the way He says they're going to turn out. God now was now actively, through Moses, even through Aaron, to set His people free. Moses thought that he was going to set the people free through combat, didn't he? That's what he was trained in. That's what he was good at. But I want you to pay attention to this carefully. Listen. He also knew. Remember, he stayed with his mother for about the first 12 years. And then until he was 40 years of age, right? When he was 40 years of age, full 40 years of age, he turned his back on Egypt. We'll read more about that. He turned his back on Egypt and he began to serve the real God of heaven. He knew this would happen. Not necessarily when, but he knew it would happen. And here's what he guarded. And sometime I think maybe I might guard this a little bit, and maybe you might guard yourself just a little bit because you've read the Bible. And you know in the last days what's going to happen. It says, you know, the daughters will turn on the mothers and the sons on the fathers, and they turn on one another and they turn you into authorities. And sometimes we're afraid to really get so involved and so embrace every little thing, even about family and friends, because you know the result, as if they don't continue to keep their eyes upon Jesus. And and maybe there may come a time that you might have to separate from them. Moses knew the time would come. And so, as we read, inspiration said Moses was, he guarded his affection and his attachment to his stepmom and to Pharaoh and to his family, his friends there in Egypt. He guarded it because he knew the time would come that he would have to separate from it. And sometimes you and I, we don't guard that, and we get so involved and we have, you know, so attached that we just can't leave certain things because we feel like we can't do it. Did you get it? What did God say to Abraham? He said, leave your family and your friends. Leave that and go to the place that I will show you. He was going to be a sojourner all of his life. None of us want to think we're on the move all the time, but you know, that's what God has, different plan. But He warns us here, and Spirit probably warns us here, we have to be careful about embracing and holding on too closely, because maybe some of those things that we may have to give up one of these days, because too much affection, too much love will cause us to make a wrong decision. He knew that. He would not be able, because of his emotions, if he wasn't careful, to fulfill the will of God. He stayed in Egypt until he was about 40. He was educated. Do you realize that Moses was a poet? That Moses was a philosopher? Moses was a general. Moses was a historian. Moses was a legislator. Man of high position in the courts of Egypt. But God was educating him to one day to be called and would respond to let his people go. But in Egypt, he was being what? He was being groomed to set up on the throne someday. Could you imagine in those days and what took place? The prestige, the honor, and the glory of the world was bestowed upon him one day. He would set as ruler. It was just around the corner for him. But because of his early teachings, he refused to bow or to worship other gods. His family said, this is the pagan practices. These are practices in which we participate. Moses, you must do it. He said, I will not. They threatened him with what? We're going to take away the crown and your crown unless you participate with us in our practices. He said, I cannot because I know the real God of heaven. What a stance he took. You know why he did it? Because it was the first 12 years of his life spent with a godly mother. He refused to worship other gods. He was threatened. His family said in Egypt, we will disown you. You continue to serve that God up in heaven they call the God of the creation. You can serve that God. We disown you. You won't be part of our family anymore. We're going to throw you out. You're not going to have any inheritance. Are you still with me? This is a real thing. We're not talking about $10. We're talking about a position. We're talking about finances. We're talking about power that you and I have no concept of in this society. And he looked beyond those things and what was instilled in his mind by his mother and his love for always wanting to find out the things of nature and the things of God, you see. Constantly going through his mind. If he continued to follow, here's what they said. You may have heard, if you continue to follow the Hebrews' beliefs, we will disown you. We've had people in the Advent movement, their family has said, if you continue to go to that church, we will disown you. And it's happened. We will disown you if you follow the faith of the Hebrews. The question comes is, what would you have done? What would I have done in that situation? It's pretty hard. All we can do is read and kind of in our minds, What would we have chosen? Oh, it's easy. Well, I would have chosen it. Really? Really? Be nice to say by faith? Yes, we'll tell you. You have to realize the background. What all happened to this man? The calling that God had upon his life. But they continued to threaten him. Listen, because of his position, they let it go for a while. I find that even in our movement today. People are allowed to get away with an awful lot because of their position. Whether it be right or wrong. Some of you are not going to get this, and that's all right if you don't get it. I get it. Because of the position, sometimes certain people are allowed to continue on in certain avenues and certain ways, right, which the ordinary man would not get away with. They can even teach things that's contrary to Scripture, and they can get away with it because of their position. It's not right. They tolerated Moses, the family did, Egypt, because of his position for a while. But the time came. The time came. You know what? The time always comes. You think you can sit idly by, or I can sit idly by, and ride the fence to now till Jesus comes. You better think again. God never called you, Brother Jim, to sit on the fence. He never called me, Terry, each one of us, to sit on the fence. I've often said when you sit on the fence, all you're going to get is some splinters. Are you still with me? Yeah. And you're going to fall eventually, what, one way or the other. God doesn't want you to fall. He wants you to get off. I'm off of the fence. Here I stand. I can't do anything else. This is what God wants from His people today. The time will come. I'm telling you, the time will come. You think it's easy. You think you're going to get by with it. Everything is good. Nobody knows the difference. God knows. Think I can get away with it. Nobody really knows. Why would you want to get away with it? The time will come when you have to make a real decision. And if you don't make it now, you're going to have to make it in a time that's much more difficult than it is right now. And if you can't make it now while it's simple, while it's easy, please don't think you'll make it when it's really tough. You won't. Only those who are experiencing Christ daily, feeding upon Him daily, right? Reading His Word, praying, spending time, witnessing to others, right? Trying to bring them to the cause of the truth of Jesus Christ, having that experience with God. Though the heavens fall, you're still going to stay there because you trust His Word. The men of God in this Bible trusted His Word when everything pointed that it wasn't going to take place. God said, I'll multiply. You remember? I'll multiply you as the stars of heaven. What happened? They were sent into slavery. They were taken into captivity. Everything seemed to go against that promise, but they held on to that promise because they knew God had said it. God had instructed Moses, this is what you're going to set my people free. And the first response should be to each one of us today is where his first response is, who am I? Too many people to say, oh good, I'm just the man for the job. That right there, that right there disqualifies you. Somebody, Brother David, they're not with it. We get that, don't we? When somebody says, I'm qualified, I can do this thing for God, that disqualifies you. Because usually when men say that, they're looking at their own qualities. They're looking at their own education, their own finance. They're looking at themselves rather than say all things are possible through God. Say, I can't do it on my own, I'm too weak. But God will help me do it. If God says so, I know He'll bring it to pass. You may say, I'm your man, I'm your woman. God, I'm the one with you. You go before me. But the time come, we'll read this last passage, we'll continue on. I know time's getting there. Turn with me to the book of Hebrews quickly. I become compassionate, right? Compassion flows out of it as I read the children of Israel and what they went through. Because they wanted to serve the true God, there was very few of them left. But there was, remember, there's always been a little remnant of people. True. Are you still with me? That's preserved the truth down. There has never been a time in Earth's history where God hasn't had His people. Do you get it? People say, oh, it's well been wiped. God has always had. He will not let the enemy wipe out. There will always be a group. And they will proclaim a message that the world doesn't want to hear. It's different than what the world wants to live up to. They think it's all easy. We're going to wander in. We're going to sleep our way into heaven. It's not going to happen. Your position won't get you there today. I'm telling you, your degrees won't get you there today. You're no exception. I'm no exception to the rule. The time will come. I'm convinced of it today, my brothers and sisters, the time will come when you're going to have to really decide. You think you may have decided, but have you? Have I really decided? Hebrews chapter 11, verses 24. Hebrews chapter what? 11, verses 24 through 26. Notice what the Bible says. It said, by faith, Moses, when he was come to years, here, what happened? He refused to be called the son of the Pharaoh's daughter. Are you still with me? The time came. 40-year-old man. A lot more time with a heathen, as it were, than with the mother. But the time came. Conviction came. The call came. He said, I refuse to be called the Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to, I'd rather suffer, what does he say? Affliction with the people of God, than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. May I tell you, the pleasures of sin is for a season. It will pass away. Do you get it? The pleasures of sin, the seemingly pleasures of sin. You say, right, the pleasures of the world, they don't last forever. Ask the people who are out there in the world. The things that they once were going about doing, oh, they've gotten older now, right? They just can't, all these things here, just, there's no joy anymore. He said, just the pleasures for a season. He said, I'd rather esteem what? Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. all the things that were in Egypt, you and I will never have any idea probably until the, you know, things you can read historical accounts in our mind. But he said, I want to give all of those up. The reproach of Christ greater. My, my. I give them up for Christ is what he's saying. I give them up for Christ. For he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. And the Bible says, by faith, he forsook Egypt. What will you do today? How will I respond? By faith, am I willing to forsake the world and the things of the world? The arm of flesh and all the things that the world and maybe even things that we think we need and so on and so forth. Not fearing what man should say or the wrath of man or what the outcome may be, but willing to, by God's grace, by faith, just forsake Egypt, forsake the things of this world and take a real decided, bold stand for Jesus. Remember, as we close, this was not an easy thing for him. It took him time to get there. But when he did, he was willing to die for what he believed in and his calling. How about you today? Some of us can't give up a little this or a little bit of that for the calling. And you have to realize God has a calling on your life. A tremendous calling. You're special. A work that only you can do. What if we fail? Because we weren't really ready to forsake our family or our friends or things of this life. I've often thought in my mind so many times, I look at my own life and I say, what could have been? It's worth thinking about. Maybe we don't know that you've missed, they say, missed the boat. But if our eyes are single to the glory of God, we might think, what really could have been if I hadn't taken this path or I hadn't taken that path? What could have been? The good news is we can call upon the name of Jesus and say, I want to get back on track. I'm willing to forsake whatever it is out there in the world. And I'm listening to your voice and I hear your calling and I want to respond to that. It's not from emotion. It's not because of somebody else is talking, somebody else is doing it, because I hear your voice. Because once Moses took that stand again, we realize, we'll study again next week, another death decree went out on him. Another one. Because after all, he became a murderer. Surely God can't use murderers. God can use anybody he wants to, anybody that's willing to be used. Friend, help. Let's pray that God will help us to be faithful and to the end. To be actively engaged in the work for Jesus Christ. I'm not going to be content this year to be set back and think it's just all comfyville. That God's people need to move on. We need to move forward. We need to be actively engaged in the winning of souls to the kingdom of God. If you commit that, your heart, your life to Him, He will make you a soul winner. He will bring people into your life. But you know what? We have to be ready for that. Here is the key. It's over. We'll discuss it more next time. The key, we think we're ready when we're not. We think we have all the answers when we do not. We think we can do it because we know so much. We think we can accomplish it because we can tell somebody how the hog ate the cabbage. We think we can accomplish it because they haven't been reading like we have and we can just, we'll show them. It doesn't work. You must have a love for that person. You're doing what you're doing because you love them. And because they may be way out on a limb, they think you're way out on one. So we take the Word of God and we take time to sit and talk with them. Let the Holy Spirit work upon the heart and the life, and you watch what takes place this year. You watch what takes place, if you're willing. If you're not, it's not going to happen. And I'm restless this year. I'm restless for the coming of Jesus. I'm restless to be doing more for the cause of Christ. And I'm not going to be content to sit back. And I'm not going to be content with false doctrine and false teaching. I will not be content. Not in this pulpit. As long as God gives breath and understanding of His Word, we must come together in unity and harmony of the Scripture and then move forward as a body. Not just coming together here, friend, coming together to pray and equip and then what? Move out. Move out. Go into what? All the world and preach and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our commission is outside these walls. If we're not doing anything outside these walls, friend, it's not going to avail. Go to the highways and the byways. Compel them to come in. Don't tell God you're too busy. He can arrange it in your life where you don't have anything else to do but lay in the bed and look up. I tell you, I've seen it. Maybe experienced it to a certain extent. Is anybody with me, or I'm the only one? He can arrange it. And you say, I'm too busy. Don't say you're too busy for God. Don't ever say you're too. Please don't. I say that not as a threat, but you'll get hurt over it. Don't. I don't want you to have to go through it. Because He wants to use you. He doesn't want you flat on your back. He wants to be using you. How about make that commitment, shall we, to God? As we begin this new year, that we're going to rearrange and do whatever God wants us to do in our hearts and our lives, whatever it is we need to give up, right? God, make it known to me. And simply not argue, not fuss, and say, well, I don't think, and it doesn't seem like. Say, Lord, not my will, but thine be done. Let's pray, shall we, together? Let's kneel. Loving Father in heaven, we thank You for Your kindness. We thank You for Your Word. We thank You for working on each of our hearts and our minds that we might be better prepared for the hour in which we live. Oh, Lord, I just feel like many times we don't comprehend these things. I try to read about them, study about it, pray about it. And I know it's real. I know it's just around the corner. But, Lord, do we really, really, really believe it in our hearts and our minds? If we do, we will make some changes. We will do something about it. Not just hearers only. Lord, bless us. We pray to this end. We pray that You'll instill Your love in our hearts and in our minds. Pray that You'll instill Your instructions, Your laws, Your commands, Your grace, Your goodness, Your faith. We have none of these things. We need You. Bless us now. We pray to this end as we take You into our hearts and minds. It's no longer my mind but Yours, that we may be used to help finish the work, and You can come. And we can go to heaven together, is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.